Hello, my name is Radi, and today I'm going to talk about the different types of electromagnetic waves and about the electromagnetic spectrum. I will try to give a simple explanation of its characteristics and ultimately give a better understanding of its practical use for space comms. We saw that we have wave solutions to Maxwell's equations, and the fact that their speed is equal to the speed of light was a hint that light is an electromagnetic wave. But what about other electromagnetic waves? Which ones can we see? What possible frequencies do they generally have? And how do we differentiate between them? So, the electromagnetic spectrum refers to many types of radiation emitted from the stars, such as our Sun. It takes many forms, such as radio waves, X-rays, and gamma rays. Visible light is also part of electromagnetic spectrum. So, let's start with the part of the electromagnetic spectrum that we can see with our own eyes, the visible light. The visible light is a very thin part of the spectrum with wavelengths between roughly around 400 and 700 nanometers. It's no surprise that we can see exactly this part of the spectrum since the Sun emits primarily in this portion of the wavelength. So, our eyes are adapted to it. But light is not only what we can see, it can be broken into different types, and we call the whole family the electromagnetic spectrum. We spoke about sources of electromagnetic waves and how we can make antennas for radio waves. But what are the antennas for visible light? How is visible light transmitted? Essentially, it is a quantum mechanical process which has to do with energy configurations of atoms and molecules. But if we look at it in a classical way, basically the electron's oscillation can be considered a source of variable magnetic and electric fields which produce electromagnetic waves. Of course, the energy of visible light is much greater than the one of the radio waves, as its wavelength is much smaller. So, light is often represented as a wave, and in that sense it can be described by its length, frequency, and speed. The different colors of visible light have different wavelengths, and so does the other from the electromagnetic spectrum. If you take a look at the picture, you will notice that the colors violet and blue have wavelength of around 400 to 460 nanometers, while red is around 620 to 700 nanometers. In other words, this explains why we see the sky blue during daytime and more reddish during sunrise or sundown. But let's take that example. So, when sunlight enters the atmosphere, it collides with the molecules of oxygen, nitrogen, dust particles, etc. And the longer red waves can pass undisturbed, but the shorter ones, as blue, collide with molecules and scatter in different directions, creating blue hues in the sky. When the sun sets, the atmosphere through which light must pass is more. And for this reason, the shorter waves that carry the blue color are scattered in the upper layers of the atmosphere, and the longer waves of the red color manage to reach us to see them. Since larger wavelength corresponds to lower frequency, we can see now where the terms redshift and blue shift comes from. So let's go back to the whole electromagnetic spectrum and take a look at where the visible light is found. It becomes clear that the visible light is only a small portion of the whole spectrum. If we look on the right part of the spectrum, we will find there the ultraviolet rays, the X-rays, and the gamma rays. They form the so-called ionizing radiation. That part includes wavelengths between 100 nanometers and 1 picometer. The ultraviolet rays interact with molecules, for example. The X-rays interact with atoms, and the gamma rays interact directly with atomic nuclei. I will not get into details here, but it is useful to mention that they are highly energetic particles, usually produced by violent cosmic events. Many modern space telescopes use these wavelengths for observation of compact objects such as neutron stars or black holes. Okay, so let's take a look at the left side of the spectrum. We find there the infrared waves, the microwaves, and the radio waves. Let's start with the infrared waves. We find them in wavelengths between 0.2 millimeters and 750 nanometers. As the name suggests, they are, we can say, below the red color and in consequence invisible to the naked eye. Our bodies, for example, emit mostly in this part of the spectrum, as maximum emission is around 900 nanometers. This class is where thermal cameras operate. Let's look at microwaves and radio waves. That is the range we are interested in regarding satcoms and data transfer. It includes waves in the range between 100 km to 1 mm. They have low frequencies and long wavelengths, and we use them for communication, TV, radar, and GNSS. This class is divided to 9 more subclasses, starting from VLF, which stands for very low frequency, to THF, that stands for tremendously high frequency. I will get into detail later in this talk. So, if we take a look at the electromagnetic spectrum as a whole, it becomes clear that the human eye is quite limited since the visible light is such a narrow band. Our focus are radio waves, since they are the part of the spectrum we use for communication purposes in space. This part is quite big, as you can see. It starts, as I said, with wavelength from 1 mm to 100 km. Even if this range can seem big, radio frequencies must be shared with terrestrial radio services. In that sense, an international frequency assignment is essential to avoid interference between all the different uses made of the radio spectrum. The more general classification is due to the ETU, or the International Telecommunication Union, and can be seen in the following picture. As you can see, here we have the band number, abbreviation, frequency range, and wavelength range. All this information can be found online on the ETU website, so I'm not going into details here. But I should mention that radio waves used for satellite communication are mostly in the range between 3 and 30 GHz. So, we dive one idea deeper into that range, and we find that it is also divided in a more detailed band. This is the classification imposed by the IEEE, or the Institute of Electrical and Electronic Engineers, and here we can see the frequency band, the range in gigahertz, and the application. These are the band designations we will be using from now on, and to which we will give the applications in the next section.